Good morning. Welcome to Granham CRC this morning. Welcome to any visitors we have with us as we seek to worship and glorify our God this morning. As you can see, we are entering the Advent season, a season where we recognize that the Christian life is a life of waiting, of anticipation, looking forward to our Lord's return. And it is Him that we seek to worship and praise this morning. And our call to worship this morning is from Hebrews 1, verses 1 through 2, and then verses 8 through 12, which reads, "In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways, but in these last days He has spoken to us by His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things and through whom He made the universe." And then verse 8, "But about the Son, He says, 'Your throne, O God, will last forever and ever, and righteousness will be the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has set you above your companions by anointing you with the oil of joy.' He also says, 'In the beginning, O Lord, you laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment. You will roll them up like a robe. Like a garment they will be changed. But you remain the same, and your years will never end.'" This is what we recognize, that throughout Scripture, the prophets, the apostles are all speaking of Christ, His first coming and His second coming, where He will bring about the new creation. And so let's now sing of our glorious Lord. We will sing, "Hark the Glad Sound, Please Rise," when the music begins. God who spoke to us, the Redeemer who came, and the Spirit who reveals Christ to us, greets us with these words. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Let's continue praising our God, singing "Angels from the Realm of Glory."
Thank you.
now have our Advent readers come forward for the Advent reading and the lighting of the Hope Candle.
Today, on this first Sunday of Advent, we light the prophecy and hope candle and think about the hope that is ours in Christ Jesus. The prophets wrote of Christ's incarnation long before his birth. As we hear the words, we remember our sin and our need for a Savior. And the New Testament writers remind us that Christ, our hope, has come and will come again, and that in him we find salvation and eternal life.
Isaiah 40, verse 1 through 5. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sin. A voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight in the wilderness a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain hill made low, the rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all mankind together will see it, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Concerning this salvation, the prophets, who spoke of the grace that was to come to you, searched intently and with the greatest care, trying to find out the time and circumstances to which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointing when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves but you, when they spoke of the things that have now been told to you by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Even angels long to look into these things.
Having heard these words of hope, seeing the candle of hope lit, please join me in a time of prayer. God of hope, you call us from the exile of sin with the good news of restoration. You build a highway through the wilderness. You come to us and bring us home. Comfort us with the expectation of your saving power made known to us in Jesus Christ our Lord. As we are in this Advent season, a season of waiting, may we hold to our hope in Christ, seeing the promises you gave to your people before us through the prophets that have their yes in Jesus Christ. As we look to Christ's first coming, may your Spirit strengthen us, that in the days to come, we may fix our eyes on your Son, Jesus Christ, being assured that as he came humbly before, he will return in glory and majesty, gathering all his people to himself. In this hope, may we as your people be a light in this world, as the candle we have lit is a light here to us. We ask for patience and perseverance, and that we may grow in our love for you as we grow in our understanding of your love for us. And it's in our Savior's name, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. Let's respond in song, singing, "Come Thou Long Expected Jesus," and again we will stand when the music begins.
People of God and our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior has established this Holy Supper, and He has commanded His followers to eat of it and celebrate it. For on the night He was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it, and He said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." And whenever we eat this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until He comes again. Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Supper that we celebrate, it is a feast of remembrance, of communion, and of hope. As Ryan had said, we expect the Lord Jesus Christ to return, and this supper reminds us that Jesus will come again, and we will sup with Him. We will celebrate the wedding feast of the Lamb when He returns. And so we come to this supper in remembrance that our Lord Jesus Christ was born into the world, that He assumed our flesh and blood, and fulfilled for us all obedience to the divine law, even to the bitter and shameful death on the cross. By His death, resurrection, and ascension, Jesus established a new and eternal covenant of grace and reconciliation, so that we might be accepted by God and never be forsaken by Him. And we come to the supper to have communion with Christ Jesus, who has promised to be with us always, even to the end of the world. In the breaking of the bread, Christ Jesus makes Himself known to us as the true heavenly bread that strengthens us unto eternal life. And in the cup of blessing, Christ Jesus comes to us as the vine in whom we must abide if we are to bear fruit. We come to the supper with hope in this Advent season. Our Lord and Savior has come, and He promises to come again in the flesh. And we believe that this bread and this cup are a pledge and a foretaste of the feast of love that is to come. And so may it be our hope and our assurance that we will indeed celebrate this feast when Jesus Christ has come and His kingdom has fully been established and rules over all creation. And we will see Jesus Christ and we will be made like Him in His glory. Let's pray. With joy we praise You, gracious God, for You have created the heavens and the earth. You have made us in Your image, and You, The ever-faithful God has kept covenant with us even when we fell into sin. You sent your Son Jesus into this world to satisfy the longings of your people for a Savior, to bring freedom to the captives of sin, and to establish justice for the oppressed. We rejoice that by believing in his life, death, and resurrection, you set before us the promise of new life and the hope of your eternal kingdom, where we will gather together at the table with Jesus Christ, our Lord and King. God of all power, send your Holy Spirit upon us, that in sharing the bread we may share in the body of Christ, and that in sharing of the cup we may share in his blood poured out for the complete forgiveness of sins. Grant that being joined together with Christ Jesus, we may become united in faith, and in all things become mature into the one who is our head, our Savior Jesus. Please accept our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord has prepared this table for all who are sorry for their sins and who believe and confess that Jesus Christ is their Lord and Savior. And if you're visiting with us today, you're welcome to partake with us if you believe in Jesus as your Savior and you seek to follow him. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. And the bread that we break is a sharing in the body of our Savior, Jesus Christ. People of the Lord, take, eat, remember and believe that the body of our Savior Jesus Christ was given for the complete forgiveness of all our sins. And the cup for which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. There's grape juice in the center ring for those who would like that. Thank you. people of Jesus Christ, take, drink, remember and believe that the precious blood of our Savior Jesus was poured out for the complete forgiveness of all our sins. Let's bow our hearts and heads in a prayer of thanksgiving. Worthy are you, O Lamb, who was slain, to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and glory and honor and praise. Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, that you have united us with Jesus Christ, and you have given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet that will come when Jesus returns and establishes his kingdom over all creation. We praise you that your Savior, our Savior, has come, and for the promise that he is and has made in coming again. Fill us with true hope and joy that is found in Jesus Christ alone, and send us out, Lord, in the power of your Spirit, to live and to work for your praise and for your glory, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord, in whom we expectantly wait. So hear our prayers, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we'll sing together What Feast of Love, and when the music plays, we'll stand together and sing this Advent hymn.
Coming yet. Slowly. Here they come. Hello. It's good to see you. Oh, one more. So it's good to see you, boys and girls, and I think you guys know what happens now, right? Yeah? Okay. So you guys are going to stand up, right? And you're going to face the congregation, and we're going to bless each other. Are you ready? Yeah? Congregation, let's bless the children, saying, "The Lord be with you." Awesome. Good job. All right, so you guys are able to go off to Sunday school now, where you guys will study God's word, just like we're going to do. So yeah, you guys can go ahead this way. You can lead the way, Owen. And for us here, our scripture reading will be from Hebrews 6. Hebrews 6, verses 13 through 20. Hebrews 6, verses 13 through 20 on page 1868 in the Pew Bibles. And before we read God's word, let's come to him in a time of prayer, asking his blessing. Let's pray. Almighty God, we are so thankful for your word that you have given us through your people, your prophets, through your apostles, through your people throughout time. And you've given your word to reveal yourself to us, to reveal your promises to us, and to give us confidence for the days to come. We pray, Lord, for your blessing over this time. May your spirit be at work in our hearts, that we will hear your word, that we will have ears to hear, that this will not pass over us, but dwell richly in us. May it bear fruit in the days to come, drawing us closer to you. And may your spirit, through your word, conform us closer to the image of Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hebrews 6, verses 13 through 20, which reads, "When God made his promise to Abraham, since there was no one greater for him to swear by, he swore by himself, saying, 'I will surely bless you and give you many descendants.' And so after waiting patiently, Abraham received what was promised. Men swear by someone greater than themselves, and the oath confirms what is said and puts an end to all argument. Because God wanted to make the unchanging nature of his purpose very clear to the heirs of what was promised, he confirmed it with an oath. God did this so that, by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled to take hold of the hope offered to us may be greatly encouraged. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain, where Jesus, who went before us, has entered on our behalf. He has become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek." This is the word of our Lord. Now, the theme of this Advent Sunday is hope. So it's worth asking, how would you define hope? Hope is a word that we use often enough. We hear it often enough in the world around us. How would we define hope? The Oxford Dictionary defines hope in this way: a feeling of expectation and desire. Now, is that all that hope is? If I hope for a certain outcome in a hockey game, for example, that is a feeling of desire. If a child hopes for a certain gift at Christmas time, that is also a feeling of desire. We might hope for better weather in the week to come, less windy possibly. Now, there might be some expectations to those desires. Say if your team is playing a poor team, or if the child told their parents what gift they wanted, or if the forecast for the week shows better weather to come. Now, those are all trivial examples, but I think the point is made. What is ultimately missing from this worldly view of hope, this understanding of hope, is confidence. And that is what defines Christian hope. It is the confidence that we have. Our hope, as our text says, is firm and secure. Our hope is confident in where it looks. And that is what our passage is telling us. We have confidence as God's people because of who our God is and his promises. If we look somewhere other than God, if we don't turn to his promises, we lose all confidence. And this is the challenge then, as God's people, to persevere and to hold fast to the hope that we have promised to us in Christ. And this is a challenge because the Christian life is a life of patience, of anticipation. The Advent season is remembering how the Old Testament saints patiently awaited the fulfillment of their hope, the coming of the promised Messiah, and the spiritual blessings that are found in him. And the Advent season is also recognizing our own patiently waiting for the second coming of that same Messiah, Jesus Christ, as we have begun to receive the spiritual blessings found in him, such as forgiveness of sins, adoption as God's children, and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. But we await the full realization of those promises in the eternal life and blessed communion with God in the new creation. As we go through life, through the various trials and hardships that we face or see others facing, our hope in the things to come may waver. So, as shown in our passage this morning, in God's grace, we receive encouragement to persevere and hold fast in confidence to the hope we have in Christ. And we receive this encouragement in two ways. First, in Abraham as an example of the faith of the Old Testament saints. And second, in who God is shown to us in his promises and oaths. So first, we are encouraged by the example of Abraham. Abraham was called by God to leave the land of his father to go where God was leading him when he was 75 years old. Now, being 75 and Sarah was 65, I think it's safe to say that Abraham was already resigned to the fact that he didn't see any children in his future. Yet Abraham receives a promise from God that God will make Abraham into a great nation, that he will have numerous descendants, and that all people on earth will be blessed through Abraham. Now, this is a foundational promise that runs throughout Scripture, that the prophets speak on and reveal in different ways. But ultimately, in order to become a nation, in order to have numerous descendants, Abraham will need to have a descendant. He needs to begin somewhere. Now, we don't have the time to go over Abraham's life in detail, but briefly, we can say that Abraham, he struggled with this promise. He wavered when he said Sarah, his wife, was his sister to avoid trouble in Egypt. And he did this twice. Abraham wavered when he sought to fulfill God's promise by his own means, by having a child with his wife's servant, Hagar. And he asked God to fulfill his promise through his son Ishmael. Abraham was about 100, Sarah 90 at this time. Yet, God promised again, Abraham and Sarah will have a son, and it is through this son that the promises will continue to be fulfilled. Now, through all of this, Abraham continues in his faith, wavering, but still trusting in God, holding to that hope to the point in Abraham's life that our passage this morning is referencing, which is from Genesis 22. Now, Genesis 22 is a pivotal chapter in the life of Abraham, because this is when God calls Abraham to sacrifice his son Isaac, the son that he and Sarah had as God promised. And this is pivotal because Isaac is the son whom, through the promises of God, will continue. If Isaac dies, how can Abraham become a great nation? How can all peoples on earth be blessed through Abraham? Yet even in the face of these questions, this intense conflict, Abraham prepared to do as God called him to do because he had hope. He trusted in the promises of God, not knowing how God would deliver him and Isaac, but trusting that God would deliver them. And God did. God stops Abraham. He doesn't offer Isaac, but receives Isaac back from the dead, so to speak. And out of this, Abraham receives even greater assurance in his hope, in that not only did he have God's promise, but now in God's grace, God condescends to swear to Abraham on his promise. As Hebrews tells us, God swore by himself, saying, "I will surely bless you and give you many descendants." 25 years after being called to a new land, Abraham waited for the child that God promised him. Through many trials, moments of wavering, Abraham waited patiently, placing his hope in God and eventually abandoning seeking to fulfill these promises by his own means, and trusted that God would deliver the son he promised. Now, it needs to be said here that our text says that Abraham received what was promised. Yet if we were to look to Hebrews 11, the chapter that describes the faith of various Old Testament saints, including Abraham, in verse 13 it says, "They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance." Now, even though it may appear so, these two statements are not in opposition. They don't contradict each other. Abraham received the beginning of the fulfillment of God's promises, but he didn't receive the completion of that fulfillment. He received his son Isaac, through whom, by Isaac's further descendant, God's promises would later come true. Ultimately, it is through the one descendant that Abraham is looking forward to, the one descendant, Jesus Christ, through whom the peoples of earth are truly blessed. But at that time, Abraham is able to begin to receive the promise through his son, Isaac. Now, ever since God promised in the garden that a seed will crush the serpent, God's people have been waiting for the coming of that seed. And this is the promise to Abraham, that through this seed, Abraham will have countless descendants. Through this seed, all peoples on earth will be blessed. The prophets spoke of this throughout Scripture, as, for example, we heard from Isaiah earlier, of the forgiveness of sins and the coming of the Lord. We hear this promise growing clearer and speaking of different aspects of this seed in different ways throughout the prophets, and we know that they were speaking of Jesus Christ. And we heard this again from 1 Peter, that the prophets understood that the Spirit was pointing them forward to the coming of Christ, of his sufferings and his glory. This is why Abraham is put forward to us as an example, because Abraham knew the promises he was given found their beginning with him and his descendants, but he waited patiently for their complete fulfillment in a later time. in the coming Messiah. Abraham, receiving God's promise and his oath, patiently waited, as our text says, and held to the hope extended to him as he prophetically passed on God's promise to his son Isaac. And as Abraham looked ahead, waiting patiently, taking hold of the hope offered in God's promise and oath, so are we to wait patiently. We look back to Abraham and his example, the promise he received, and the expectation of the coming Messiah, and we see how God keeps his word as the Messiah Jesus Christ truly came. So we too are called to wait patiently as we look ahead to Christ's second coming. Now, the author of Hebrews gives us encouragement in the example of Abraham waiting patiently, and he offers us encouragement in who God is and the Word of God. Last week, Pastor Henry reminded us of the weight of our words, our oaths. Oaths bind us and hold us accountable to the one we swear by. This is why, as we heard last week, we must be careful and truthful in our word. And if we're honest, we don't always keep our word. Yet God always keeps his word. God is faithful, and there is certainty in his promises. God's promises alone are a source of tremendous encouragement and hope for the believer. Yet, as our passage says, God goes further than promises. God doesn't need to, yet, so that we may be greatly encouraged, we, the spiritual descendants of Abraham, the heirs of the promise, God confirms his promise with an oath. God himself never changes. He is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and so he never goes back on his word. And as our passage says, it is impossible for our God to lie. And God, having his promises, his oaths, has a purpose. He has a plan, and that purpose and plan will never change. And again, God doesn't need to, but out of his love for his people, he makes it clear to us the unchanging nature of his purpose, his plan of redemption. And our passage says that God did this by two unchangeable things. And those two things are his promise and his oath. God accommodates to Abraham's weak faith, repeating the promise and giving his oath, and our own weak faith in the same manner. When we hear the unchangeable God give us his promise and oath, seen in the promise to Abraham and the promise in Psalm 110 that Christ will be priest forever, when we hear these promises, that if we put our faith in Christ, that we will have the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting, we have hope, knowing that God is true to his word. Now, this isn't a new concept that Hebrews is introducing that God's people would have otherwise been unaware of. God has made his unchanging nature known of himself from the beginning with one clear example from Numbers 23, verse 19, which reads, God is not a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should change his mind. Does he speak and then not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? When God promises something, he fulfills that promise. And that fulfillment usually isn't in the timing that we prefer. It's in God's timing. Yet he always fulfills his promise, and that never changes. We have firm and secure hope in who our God is, the faithful, unchanging God who keeps his promise and confirms that to us by his oath. And typically, when one swears an oath, the someone greater that they swear by acts as judge if they break that oath. And in the times of Abraham, for example, the judgment was usually the death penalty. For example, in Genesis 15, when God makes his covenant promise with Abraham, Abraham brings forward various animals, cuts them in half, and places them in two rows. Now, this was typical of all covenant promises at that time. The parties making promises would walk between these pieces, essentially saying, if I break my word, let me be as these animals. What has been done to them, let it be done to me. Yet, in Genesis 15, it is God, not Abraham, who walks between those pieces. And since there's none greater than God, he swears by himself, as seen in Genesis 22, invoking himself as judge. So how can we, as God's people, not have confident hope when our God who cannot lie gives us his promise and our God who cannot die gives us his oath? By these two unchangeable things, God's oath and promise, we are encouraged to take hold of the hope offered us, just as Abraham has done. The hope we have in Christ is vastly different from the hope we see offered in the world. Hope there is simply a desire, a wish. Hope is wanting but not having. Yet our hope is in what we have, Christ, and what we are promised in him. This isn't an empty hope, but a rich hope that allows us to persevere in whatever circumstances we face. And so in closing, Hebrews gives us this picture of our hope in Christ and salvation in him as an anchor. And then our text says in verse 20 that Jesus went before us. Now, keeping with the imagery of anchor, other translations say that Jesus was a forerunner on our behalf. And having those two images together is important and helps us understand how Christ, our hope, secures and holds us firm. And to what is a forerunner? One commentator helpfully explains forerunner in this way. He says, the Greek harbors were often cut off from the sea by sandbars, over which the larger ships dared not pass till the full tide came in. Therefore, a lighter vessel, a forerunner, took the anchor and dropped it in the harbor. From that moment, the ship was safe from the storm, although it had to wait for the tide before it could enter the harbor. The entrance of the small vessel into the harbor, the forerunner carrying the ship's anchor, was the pledge that the ship would safely enter the harbor when the tide was full. And because Christ, our forerunner, has entered heaven itself, having torn asunder everything that separates the redeemed sinner from the very presence of God, he himself is the pledge that we too shall one day enter the harbor of our souls and the very presence of God in the New Jerusalem. In this Advent season, we're reminded of the anticipation we live in, awaiting Christ's return. At his return, those in Christ look forward in hope to their bodily resurrection and the joy of being with our glorious Savior forever. So let us hold fast to our hope in Christ, knowing that he will return. Amen. Let's pray. Almighty God, what a comfort and encouragement it is to be reminded of your unchangeable nature, of your promises that you've given us, your people. May we hold fast to those promises, resting in Christ, seeing how he has gone before us, securing our place. We pray, Lord, that Our understanding of these things will grow in the days to come. We pray, Lord, that as we look to the days ahead, that this hope that we have will be made evident in our lives, that each day we will go out in confidence, being assured of who you are and what our Savior Jesus Christ has done. We're thankful for the examples of Abraham and the other Old Testament saints of patiently waiting. We're thankful, above all, for the sending of your Son, the fulfillment of your promises, the one that we look forward to. And may we live in glorious expectation as we await that day of his return. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We respond in hope and we will sing, O come, Emmanuel. Please stand when the music begins.
Thank you.
God, all that is on our hearts, our joys, our thanksgivings, our concerns. Our God hears us, so let's lift up our hearts in prayer. O Lord, there is no God like you, in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and showing steadfast love to your servants who walk before you with all their heart. When we look at your creation, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what are we that you are mindful of us, that you care for us? Yet in the vastness of creation, you hear us, you know us. So we humbly bring before you all that is on our hearts. We give thanks, Lord, for your church, the church across the globe, and we think particularly of this local congregation here in Granham. We ask that your fatherly hand continue to be with us. May we have gratitude for the gifts you have given us. May we have patience when we go through times of trials or suffering. We confess to you that you are our rock and refuge, an ever-present help in trouble. We ask for your help, your comfort, to be with those who may be mourning, grieving loved ones. We continue to pray for the DeBoer family, mourning Sonia's father. We think of their extended family at this time. We think of the extended Pullman family of Hetty, as well as all those who may be grieving recent or more distant lost loved ones. We also ask, Lord, for your healing to be with those who are sick, undergoing treatments, recovering from surgeries or any illness. We are thankful for the knowledge, wisdom, and skills that you have given us, your people, and recognize that any healing ultimately comes from you. As your people, we lift our concerns to you, Lord. You know what is on our hearts, and we ask, Lord, that we trust you in all things, and that we will grow in that trust. We also give thanks, Lord. We are very thankful for the various members of the body here and all that each one has to offer. Thank you for those who serve in different ways, and we ask that as your people, we will continue to have a giving heart flowing from the gratitude we have towards you in the sending of your Son. We ask that Christ will be proclaimed clearly here among us, but also across the globe. We give thanks for the pastors, missionaries, all of your people who proclaim the name of Jesus and seek to be the light that you have called us to be. We pray for continued growth in your church across the globe, that your kingdom will continue to expand. We ask, Lord, for the restraining of evil. We ask that human dignity will be recognized and the sanctity of life will be protected. There's always more on our hearts, Lord, more that we can bring to you. So we ask that you assure us that you know our hearts and you do hear our prayers. And we lift this prayer to you, Father, asking these things of you through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever praised. Amen. At this time, the deacons will come forward for the offering. There are two offerings this morning, one for the general fund and one for the benevolence.
Thank you. Shall we pray? Dear Lord, thank you so much for all the many blessings you pour onto our lives every day. As we come to the season of your birth, it's a joyous time, but it can be a very trying time for some. Let these gifts be used in that way to help those who are less fortunate. In your name, amen.
After the service, you are encouraged and welcome to have a time of fellowship over coffee, conversation. And as we prepare to leave this place, know that our gracious God sends us with his blessing. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with the hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's close singing, Blessed Be the God of Israel.